Good morning. I think it's morning. I'm not sure, but I wasn't gonna make this video, but I decided to make it because it's a follow-up to what I said yesterday. The depths of a compulsion can take you to the pits of it. And that's what it is. I'm coming at you at my worst, and I don't care. I washed my face this morning when I got home, and I think there's still mascara under my eyes. I haven't slept yet, but I spoke about this before in a video prior to this one, yesterday's video about the things that are on my mind, even with the legal pending situation that is, I feel is so dangerous. And that is, an idea that I couldn't let go of. But who suffers? Only I do. And that being a sexual compulsion brings me here today. I didn't want to go back to him. I didn't plan on going back to him. Not last night. But I found myself on his doorstep. And I knew how emotionally bad it could be, and it is. But I'm handling it. I went out with a guy last night that I didn't know, and I didn't like him. The more he spoke, the less I liked him. I didn't like him from the beginning, and I just didn't like him. I was not attracted to him, although he thought he was pretty fucking attractive. He thought he was really good looking. But that's not the point. He was an asshole. You know, at first he was really nice and, I personally didn't like him. I didn't care for him. I saw nothing in him that attracted me in any capacity. But the whole time he was sitting there talking, and he kept talking and talking. And barely asked me about me. He was just talking because I suppose he's a type B narcissist, and that's my term for it. Anyways, whatever. And I sat there and I thought to myself, I said it in my head, I don't even like you, but I'm wondering how quick we can have sex so I can go home. That's not good. Anyways, it turned out to be a semi-disaster. nothing came of it. And I couldn't even see myself kissing him. That's, anyways, I wouldn't want to kiss him. But I went home and I decided I'm going to go back to him. The only one that I can think about for 2 years since I've met him. The only one that could ever be for me everything bad and everything that I couldn't give up. I want him. I think about him constantly. I've left him a million times and I've gone back to him when he bullied me. And always regretted finding myself back with him. And I would leave him again and again. I met him about 2 years ago when the father of my child took my child, my beautiful, perfect baby, in court. And not even based on parenting, because I was an amazing, wonderful mother and parent. Had nothing to do with my parenting. He is a devout Muslim and a sociopath, much like my mother. She's not Muslim, but we're not talking about that. We're talking about the disorder and how it's wrecked my life and how I allow these types into my life. And so, long story short, and what hurts me the most ever, and what could ever hurt me the most and does, is my child having been taken away. Unjustly. But the day that the court commissioner took my child away after a lengthy, about a year and a half, battle of mine in children's court, I left that day and I went to his apartment strictly to see my baby and hold my baby. And there was my baby and he wouldn't let me touch him. I drove for hours and hours aimlessly. And when I finally turned around and went home, I didn't drink or eat for days. I was lost. And nothing, I wouldn't have anything for days. And on the sixth day, I went out to see a woman and talk to her. And on my way home, I decided maybe I should finally drink and eat. And I stopped somewhere. And all I wanted was a quick salad just to buy and take home. And the place didn't have one, so I went across the street to a market. And I grabbed a quick salad and I was standing in line to pay for it. And there he was. I met him for the first time and he spoke. And he could see, and who couldn't see, the misery and the hurt on my face. And just out of nowhere, he was standing three people behind me in line. Yeah, three people behind me. He said, "Oh, it'll be okay." And I turned around and I saw him, and he was not somebody that I would normally talk to. He wasn't my type. He wasn't anybody that I would normally be interested in. So I turned back around, ignored him, and then he said, I promise you, you'll be okay. And I turned around again. The first thing out of my mouth was, "Will you pray for me?" And he introduced himself and he took me outside to the parking lot. And we started talking and I told him everything. And he said, oh, that happened when my son was a child and his mother took him from me. And we talked and I asked him to pray for me. And I told him I just wanted a friend and he gave me his number and I never planned on calling him though. I just had no interest. And maybe a week later I did call him and he didn't answer, but he texted me back. And after that he would take me out and get me things and we would talk. And I knew he was interested in me, but I was not interested in him, and I would try to avoid the subject. But there was one point, one day, when something changed in my eyes. Was it because he did a lot of things for me? I don't know what it was, but I was so into him. And that was about 2 years ago. And at the time he had a girlfriend and he told me that he was all alone. And I believed him. I didn't know that he too was a disordered personality, a sociopath. And I'm sure that I'm a disordered personality too, but not that disorder. So at any rate, I just wanted him. I wanted him. I was very interested in him. I wanted him with a, I don't know, I was just drawn to him. And when he told me that he didn't have anybody and Valentine's Day was coming up, I told him, oh, I'll be your Valentine. And to me, it was a joke. But when I became interested in him, we got together and we were in a relationship. And he took me out for Valentine's Day. And ever since then, we were together. Even when I found out about his girlfriend, I got mad at him and I left because he cheated me. And he cheated her, well, he cheated on her. He made me the side chick, and I promised myself that I would never be that again. But of course, in line with his personality, he would keep calling me and chasing me, and I went back to him, and I went back to him, and I left him, and I went back to him. And I always wanted him. It was so rocky and so destructive of a relationship in every way. He would do things to me that he knew would get me. And I would bite into it, not just feed into it, but I would bite into it. And I would clamp on. Then I would leave, and then I would go back, and then I would leave, and he would manipulate me into going back, and I would go back to him. And he's the only one who knows me inside out. He's the only one who knows everything that I like and everything that I don't. He knows the freak that I am. He gives it to me like I want it. He does it like I want it. He knows me. He understands me. He's seen me at my worst. He's seen me at my best. He's the one who's always cleaned up when I was the biggest mess. When I get sick, he's the one who was always cleaning up, taking care, nurturing, mothering, fathering. And sexually, there was no one like him. I've been in a lot of relationships. There are those that I was into, there are those that I wasn't into. We've all had them. There were those that took me a while to get over, and there were those who I forgot about maybe 2 hours later and didn't care. And still don't. But this is different. There's something about him. And it's bad. But there's something about me that draws me to him. When you're drawn to someone inexplicably and you can't be away, look to yourself because it's something in you. It's something in you. It's a compulsion in me. There's something in me unresolved and undefined. I left him for good about a year ago. But I'm on his rotation list. He's going to call me. With him, it's never over. In his mind, it's never over. Even when it's over, he's going to keep calling me. And he did. And but you know what? At that time, I was done with him. There was no unfinished business. I was done. The only reason I went back to him was a sexual thing, because I had met someone and it was really, really good with that guy. And I don't know what it was about that other guy, but I wanted to repeat everything that we had done one night. I had a one-night stand with him, and I intended it to be only a one-night stand. It just was so good. And by the time this one called me again, I went back to him, and I intended that to be a one-night stand with him. And he took me back. He took me back. Well, he came and actually physically took me back when I finally answered his call. But it turned out that for him, it wasn't just a one-night thing, and there was a manipulation and bullying again, so I found myself staying with him. And then it got to the point where I couldn't stay away from him. So there we were together, back again. And then I left him and went back, left him and went back. And he became more and more demanding and bullying. Every time I'd leave him, he would cut me to the bone with his words. He would knock me down with his words. And the bullying would start again, and I went back to him. And then last year, it ended really badly because I found out he had been doing some seriously bad things behind my back. To me. I'm not going to say what they are at this point. I don't know if I am going to ever say what he did to me, but he's so much like my mother. He takes a piece of you to take your soul from you. He reminds me of my mother. With her, she would take my clothes and keep them. When I was in high school, she would steal my clothes and keep them because she wanted a piece of my soul. And you would think that, so what, it's just clothes. You have to understand people like this to know why they do the things that they do. They take personal articles, or they might even take your pictures, knowing that you don't want them to take your pictures. With him, that's what he he did a lot of horrible things behind my back, and it ended really, really badly when I left him this last time. Last night I came home from going out with that guy, and I found myself getting in my car and driving down to his house, and I found myself on his doorstep. I rang the bell once, no answer. I rang the bell twice, no answer. I rang it a third time, no answer. So I was just about to leave, and then I saw him in his truck pulling up. He had gone to the store and he came back. And he saw me, he got out of his truck, and I turned around on his doorstep and I saw him. And he was so happy to see me, he couldn't stop talking. But I stood there silent. Because let's face it, he knew why I was back. He knows me. He knows me inside out. He knows me so well. And he's ready and willing to give it. He knew. So we went inside, and then we stepped out and went to the store. We bought something to drink. And we came back to his house. And I just went at it, and I got so sick. I got so sick, and there he was to clean up after me. I was vomiting all night and coming all night. There he was, mommy and daddy. Boyfriend of mine. Sex compulsion of mine. Nobody can be like him. I know that for me to stay with him would be me never staying with myself. And by that, I don't mean that I would lose myself. I'll never lose myself in a relationship to anybody. I have a strong identity. I know who I am. I know what I am. I know where I want to go. I know all the things that I want to do in my life. I'm very ambitious, I'm very goal-oriented, I'm very strong, and I'm very courageous, and I would never lose myself to anybody. But to be with him would be to destroy me in a different way. And at 6 o'clock, he made the bed for us to go get into. And I got on the bed, and then I got off. I had to leave. And I told him to please go back to his girlfriend. And of course, he denied it, like all good sociopaths do. He denied that he had a girlfriend. And I told him that she, I don't know. He always said she was such a bitch. And she mistreated him. But that's the usual script with them, with those type personalities. And maybe in his mind, it's not over. Maybe in his mind, because he knows me so well, he's sure that he'll make it to not be over. But in my mind, it's done. It's not easy. It's really, really hard. But in my mind, I know that I can't go back to that place in my life. The day my child was taken from me is the day, 6 days later, I met him. And since then, he's the only one in my mind who could ever be for me what he is. And if that adequately explains it or gets the meaning across to anybody who's watching this, or to the very few at this point who are watching this, fine. And if it doesn't, that's fine too. I don't care. I don't care. I got home this morning. I bathed, scrubbed myself, washed my face, brushed my teeth, and pulled on some clothes, and that's it. Not wearing a bra because I don't care. I guess that's one of my ways of not caring. I'm not leaving this house to do anything because I don't care. I'm very physically sick right now. I've been trying to get some electrolytes. Thank God for salsa, because I've been pigging out on salsa all morning. I cooked salsa and chips. But I'm very unsteady and I'm very sick right now, and I'm at a place in my head that I don't want to be at. Somebody asked me 2 months ago, because I walked into a place and I spoke to a really, really nice girl about the situation, and she asked me, she said, "You can't let go of him in your mind because he's not letting go of you. Have you asked him to let go of you?" And I didn't answer. But I thought about it later, because it didn't dawn on me what she was asking me. It dawned on me after I left and I got in my car and drove off. And in my haze last night, and all I could do was just beg him to stop thinking about me, to let go finally. So he laughed and asked me, "Is that what you really want?" And I said, "Yes." And he said, "Then I won't do it." See, the energy that I talk about is very, very important. It's not just energy that you put out. It's energy that others put out that can make you put yourself into situations, because ultimately it's us who get ourselves into the situations that we're in. We can't blame anybody else in the long run, because no matter what anybody does, no matter what you believe in and what you think, we have the willpower to combat it. We have the willpower to fight it. But not everybody uses their willpower. Not everybody is, just like I said before, not everybody is in touch with their subconscious. There are advanced people who are. But we don't know them personally. But they exist. They're very, very few, but they exist. So if we can't be what they are, then we have to use outward willpower. We have to tap into that willpower, into that point which will help us discipline ourselves. And I haven't mastered it, far from it, but I'm trying. I see why people are with the people they are, because if you're shallow and you look at it from the outside looking in, if you're an outsider, like I've been an outsider a lot in my life, and I look at people and I ask myself, why is this guy attracted to that woman? Why is he with that woman? Why are they married, or why are they engaged when aesthetically he could do so much better? See, it's not about aesthetics, it's not about looks, and looks never mattered to me. Although I look at people and things and I really analyze and I ask myself things, it's never about looks. It's about what it is in that person that's, and what it is in us that's drawing us like magnets towards each other. People are with people for whatever reasons they have within themselves. Why was I with him? Or if we went out, somebody might be analyzing us, people watching as a sport, or happen to glance our way and ask, well, why is she with him? I was with him because I couldn't not be with him. And even now, there's something in me that wants him. Physically, but also emotionally. But I know that would be ruin. And there's a point that I have to say no. But it seems like circumstances are working against me right now. I just got a phone call from the people who have my dog temporarily. They've had him for a few months because the safest thing would be, because of my court situation, because the courts have screwed me so many times and wrongfully put me in custody. And had my dog been in the house, it would have done me. Because my dog can't be alone. Somebody has to take care of him. So, long story short, with that one, I put out the word and I met some people, and they've had him. Before that, though, he had him. He has a little dog of his own. And my baby is a beautiful, gorgeous pit bull. But he is more gentle than a newborn kitten. He's extremely gentle, and he's an angel. He's a lovely, lovely dog. And at first he wouldn't even get near him. He told me he'd been bitten before, this, that, and that. And so whatever, you know, even though he's trained Rottweilers before. So because of my court situation, he took my dog and he kept my dog at his house. He was worried for his little dog. He has a little Pomeranian, and it's a little tiny little rat-looking thing. But he was worried about his dog, and I told him that my dog is not what you think, and he didn't believe me. And he didn't want to hear it. But one time, me going back to him also depended on my dog. So he took my dog. He took my dog and he made a home for him in his house. And those two had to get along. So even though my dog would eat all of his dog's food, he would sleep in his dog's bed. It was funny, but we became a family. You know, he took my dog, he trained my dog, he did a lot for him. And then when I left him, I took my dog with me when it ended really badly. There's no way I was going to leave my dog there. And that's when the struggle began to really find someone to take my dog, because at the time the court had given me a sentence before they reneged. And I had been sentenced and I was set to turn myself in. So I was struggling and rushing to find a good temporary home for him while I would be doing that sentence. And at the very last minute, I found these people and they took my dog and they've been taking really good care of him. Coincidence of coincidences, yesterday I got a call from them that I need to take him back because they have a situation of their own. So here I am. I just pray and I keep my faith, and my faith will keep me. And you guys remember, be strong in your faith. Keep your faith and your faith will have and hold you. See you soon.